Morning. Good morning. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day. And a little bit of feedback. Negative feedback. Oh! God, we just thank you so much for this time and this morning, Lord, to be able to be present in this place right now. Lord God, I pray that you would put a song in our hearts, Lord God. Let it be a sign of the joy and the peace that you are pouring out on all people, that you are transforming us from the inside out by the renewing of our minds, Lord God, that we won't just read about how you work and how your spirit comes in the scriptures. We will be able to live a life filled to abundance because of Jesus and the spirit that he gives us here and now. Lord God, let us not miss out on any opportunities and just have your will accomplished, Lord God, and your kingdom come each and every day in Jesus' name. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Amen. Seated.
Thank you. scriptures revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring. Every creature unique and the song that it sings. All explained. Indescribable.
Saturday was silent, surely it was true. Since when has it possible ever stopped you? Friday's disappointment, Sunday's empty too. Since when has it possible?
Resurrection. he wants to, just as the man who was thrown on the bones of Elisha. There's anything that he can't do, just as the stone that was rolled at the tomb.
Come and do the work that only you can do, that we need you to do, that we plead for you to do right now, Lord God. Holy Spirit, come with fire, with water, and like rain, Lord God, descend upon your people who are desperate and hungry and thirsty, Lord God. We need your righteousness, Lord God. We need your righteousness, Lord God. And we pray that declaration of what God says. God said, live. God said, live.
Live. This is the sound of the tribe.
Father. Holy Spirit. Oh, Lord, thank you, Father. Holy Spirit, live. Holy Spirit, Lord God, come on, Jesus. Thank you.
Oh, Lord, thank you.
Lord, your declaration of yes and amen. God, there is nothing you can't do. Lord God, in that you are willing and able. You are willing and able. Time and time again, Lord God, you prove in the scriptures that you are willing and you are able. There is no limit to either your will or your action. Lord, may you speak the words of life, the words of liberation and freedom, not of condemnation or shame or judgment, but of freedom through Jesus Christ, Lord God, that in your blood and through your name, we are made clean and righteous and forgiven, and we are called sons and daughters of God, brought into a shared inheritance with Jesus Christ, getting everything that he has coming to him and taking everything away that I had coming to me before Christ. God, I stand in the affirmation and the knowledge and the authority that I am who you say I am. And nothing and no one is going to take away my identity in you.
Yes, Lord.
And we all say that together, Lord God, because we are your children. We are made new. We are not stuck in the past. The past is gone. Only the enemy remembers. You do not remember everything, every mistake, every sin, every brokenness, Lord God, that comes before. I thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. No. Chair's already there for me. Thank you. It's amazing to me. I was thinking this morning how when Moses is talking to God through a burning bush, and there's this seemingly ridiculous circumstance, and he's engaging with God, and God is speaking to him, and God says, remove your shoes because you are on holy ground. How much more with the Spirit of God inside of us are we holy people because he is in us. Amen. It's not just the ground, it's our lives, it's our character, it's who we are has been made holy because of Jesus Christ. And that is why every week we partake and remember what Jesus did. And when he said, it is finished, it is accomplished, that meant now and forever and for all people, the needed work is done. And when the enemy comes and says, you're not good enough, you say, yes, I am, because it's finished. And when you have a doubt, you have a misstep, and you fall back, you fall behind, and you think, oh, God, I should know better. He says, I've got you. He picks you up. He dusts you off. He sends you out again because it is finished. It is done. We are covered and washed in the blood of Christ now and forever. May I have this verse, please? I'd like to introduce you to an MLA Falcon Ridge, Evan. Yeah. And I know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now. We are standing.
presence on holy ground.
Jesus took the bread and he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you." This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins and the removal of sins. Amen. As they come around, they collect the cups. Mel's coming up here, aren't you? No? You getting the kids? You just sitting? No? Kids are dismissed? All right. The youngins. When we take the offering plates around, just as a reminder, it is not under obligation that we call anyone to give. It is not our desires or our will. And we do not ask that you give stringently out of fear of not having enough. It's to be done with a joyful heart in all that we do, and every step and every motivation of our life, day in and day out, is to be saturated in our relationship with God in response to His goodness. We can only give because we were first given. That is the whole point. So God, whatever that is, it doesn't matter, Lord. There is no judgment or expectation, but God, let it be done out of the right heart, a heart that is connected and just molded with yours, Lord God, right now. Thank you for giving us, Lord God. Freely we have been given, so Lord, let us freely give, free of guilt, burden, shame, judgment, condemnation, Lord God, financially with our time, our motives, our energies, everything, Lord God. Let us be a people that live in such divine relationship and revelation of who you are. We want to respond to that by giving ourselves. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh, I'm so glad that we closed off the worship with Rattle. You know, and it's funny because when Teresa and I were working on that song this morning, I just had that was one part, and there's so many versions of that song. I mean, there's so many. One band, they've got like four different live versions, and that one part that this is what they said, this is what God says to live. And then there's a call and the beck and response. And that, to me, is so powerful. That's a declaration of not only what God says, but what we are saying in response to that call. Jesus says, "I came to give life and give it abundantly." So God, right now, I am so thankful of you that we have this opportunity communally and together, Lord God, to step into time to engage with you with prayer. Lord Jesus, let us not just pour out our heart's desires, because you want that. You want our burdens. You want our sufferings. You want our shortcomings. And right now we choose to release that to your feet right now. But God, also your spirit wants to fill up, to pour into, Lord. Our posture in life is supposed to be this, palms open and upright, that we may be poured into, Lord God. We are not called to be drained. We are called to be filled with the Holy Spirit, Lord. So Jesus, right now, as we enter this time, you know the state of our world, Lord. You know the state of our world and the state of our hearts. So Jesus, if there are prayer requests, if there are praise reports, if they're lifted up privately or publicly right now, Lord God, we know you hear our prayers and we celebrate together. We heal the grieving and the mourning and the loss together. But Lord, we do it together because we have been bound together with you, together in you, in Jesus' name. So Lord, right now, hear our prayers.
Father, in the name of Jesus, I just praise and I thank you. It's, I can't fathom, it's beyond my understanding. My cup is overflowing, it is spilling out. I just ask you to have it spill out to other people, my brothers and sisters, my friends and my relatives and my neighbors. It's just overflowing to the point, Lord, that everything, every light casts a shadow. Well, Lord, you don't cast a shadow. Your light is all-consuming and there is no shadow. I feel like I'm walking in the light of the Lord, and I just feel so honored and blessed, and I just, the desire of my heart is that people would open up their hearts and accept Jesus, walk in his love and his joy and his peace. It's there for us. It's paid for us. It's for us just to ask and receive. And you will just be so blessed and so peaceful and so anointed of the Lord. I just praise and I thank you for that. I just thank the Holy Spirit for working in each and every one of you. I pray God that you don't let the sun set on this day before you and say, Lord, I want everything that you've given Aaron and Melanie. I want to receive that peace and that joy and that love. I want to walk in your stead. I want to walk in the footsteps of the Holy Spirit. I want you to do through me the thing that you want to do. In Jesus' name.
Lord, thank you for the grace of left field surprises in all of our lives. Much appreciated, and for the joy that you can find in all the victims of Alberta, for instance, that might be suffering, seemingly. Thank you.
Holy Spirit, I ask that you come down this morning, Lord, and you speak louder than any other spirit that people may be hearing. Even if they think it's the voice of God, Lord, and the enemy is a liar, he is a deceiver, and he is trying to dampen the work of the Lord. God, may your Holy Spirit go before us this morning, God, and speak louder than anything else that anyone is hearing this morning, Lord. Your Holy Spirit touch their lives. Your Holy Spirit be whispering in their ear. God, I'm here to remind the enemy that this is a sanctuary. Fill the Holy Spirit, and they're not welcome here.
Yes.
Holy Spirit, speak loud. Uncover the eyes, ears, and hearts of everyone here and everyone listening who continue to listen, Lord.
Consider the threats of the enemy. God, enable your servant to proclaim your word, not mine, with great supernatural boldness. Stretch out your hands to perform healings and miracles and signs and wonders in this place, in this body, as you see fit, through the anointed giftings and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, Lord God. And let the foundation of every place we enter shake, because you are in us. In Jesus' name, amen. Lord, and also I just want to think of that banner at the back of the room there, Lord God, and I thank you that your grace for each and every one of us, your purposes as you have designed for each and every one of us, Lord God, and the way that you think about us with value and the way you see us through your lens will never change. It's irrevocable. God, give us the ability to see that, to understand it, and know it, Lord God, and humbly let ourselves be accessible to you in all that we think, say, and do, that it may be in line with your character, not ours, in Jesus' name. Amen. How was your week? Tell me about it. I had 9 people plus bonuses come through my house this week and sit in our living room with a bunch of people who have different giftings. And we prayed and we saw, and I'm claiming this right now, we saw healings and miracles. We saw the lame walk. We saw suicide cast away. We saw lives restored, relationships mended this week. And I'm not saying that lightly. I saw and I lived the impossible because God is good. Here's the thing about it, though, and this is the word I had to share with several people, and this is not a condemning word, and this is a word for a lot of us. When God starts moving in the supernatural and the impossible, we want the instant gratification because that's how Jesus did it. But for some of us, it's a journey. It doesn't mean the prayer is not yes and amen, but he did the work in me through my healing, and it wasn't just the body. It was the transformation of my life through renewing of my mind. It took a bit of time, but it is there, and it's yes. But if we want God only for this purpose, this is the warning. God, just give me the healing so I can go right back to the life the way that I want it to be. That is not what he is in the business of doing. If you're looking for the same routine of comfortability and conformity that serves you over him, he is not going to be able to do in your life what you want him to do, even if his answer is yes and amen. The transforming of our mind transforms everything. I am a person, and this isn't me bragging on me, this is how God works. I am a person who loves media. And in fact, when I was sick, I was self-medicating by drowning myself in entertainment, trying to keep my mind off my current predicament. It was TV, it was movies, it was video gaming, it was my phone to mindlessly scroll through whatever social media platform was available at that time. I don't want any of it now. I haven't watched TV in a couple of weeks. I don't have a desire. I don't play video games except for maybe a couple times because God's like, do this, but I want you to listen to this. And I didn't, it was weird. Everything that I've loved and liked has changed. I don't listen to podcasts from other preachers anymore. It's not because I'm arrogant, because God says, let my voice be the only voice that influences what you're going to say to my people. So I'm like, okay. And I'm sitting here and I'm absorbing the different things. What I literally do, I sound like the type of people I made fun of in Bible college. I'm with my family and I'm reading this and I'm listening to podcasts of different prophetic messages for the church today. That's all I do. My life from the outside is so boring, but it is so alive. And this week, as we laid hands on people, every single person got something. Because God says, and I love this in Scripture, that when the sick and the lame and the diseased and everyone that had ailments were brought to him, it says, he healed them all. And that is why God is so good. It was prophesied before this week even took place, and I don't use that word lightly either because I have great reverence for it, that this week would be one of the most important weeks of my life and Melody's life. And people who came through our midst, I saw amazing things. But before I start getting into that, I got to get to some of this. Or we're going to be here all day. There's no PowerPoint. If you want to try and follow along, great. If not, just listen. Because these are the things that were revealed to me this week. In Acts chapter 4, verse 12, it says, there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given freely by people by which we must be saved. For God has provided the world no alternative for salvation. It's only in Jesus Christ. Now, what I didn't know, the words that are used, and if you really want to look at it, the words in the use that Peter is speaking right now, that are being spoken right now, come from the Hebrew language of what salvation actually means. And I'm someone who went to seminary, okay? I went through education 4 years, got my bachelor's degree. I walked the church pastoral life for over a decade plus now with Melody. And what's amazing to me is I never really took the time to understand the depth of salvation because I grew up in the church. I know it all, right? No. And when I looked at the word for salvation in the Hebrew language is Yasha, which is literally the summation of where we get the name Yeshua, which is Jesus Christ. His name literally means salvation, so literally there is no other name. And the definition of that word means healing and deliverance. There is an expectation when we are saved, we are delivered from what? What did Jesus intercede on our behalf when he prayed to the Lord? Deliver us from evil, implying there is a need of something to be delivered from. There's already a supernatural thing that we need to expect needs to take place in our lives if we are saved. And healing is also the expectation because it's right there, number one, in the definition of salvation. And I mean, God does an inner work healing in all of us, but he's also capable of healing every area of our life that is needed as he sees fit because he is the one who saves. No one else, no other name, nothing else, Jesus and Jesus alone. And if we can't start there and proclaim that over ourselves, and what I love about that is that's what Scripture says, because that is what's professed over us. There is power in what we say. There is proof in what we say. When we say, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord, we are stating that if I'm in a season where I am so dry and there is no substance and I am needing something so badly, God says, live, become made whole, alive, healed, restored, and new. Matthew chapter 12, second half of verse 34 says, the mouth speaks out of that which fills the heart. The heart is your character of who you are. The mouth is going to prove true who you are, even if you try to convince yourself you're somebody else. What you say is going to be the absolute truth to you and to the world of who you are. The good man from his inner good treasure brings out good things, and the evil man from his inner evil treasure brings out evil things, because where our heart is, our treasure is there also. The things that we cleave to and say, this is special, this is important, that's what's going to be proved right by our words. And in fact, the scripture goes on in so many different places to say, our words have two outcomes, good, bad, the power of life and death, the power of blessing or the power of cursing. There is no middle ground. There is no neutral words. It is life or it is death, what we speak over ourselves, what we profess over other people. So if we rise up in judgment against somebody else, God says, no. In fact, it says in Scripture, every tongue that rises up in judgment against us, the Lord shall condemn. Ooh, I better be careful of what I say. God, change my heart, change our character this day and every day forward that we may be speaking life. And who do you speak life over? Yourself and other people. So often I see so many people that are willing to love others, but you are not willing to love yourself. And if we don't grasp our identity in Christ, how can we fully be transformed by the renewing of our mind? How can the healing work of salvation take its full effect if we're not willing to receive what Scripture and Jesus says, this is who you are? That is the greatest healing. And you know what's interesting? That brings about when we receive that we are covered and sanctified by the blood of Jesus, a lot of times that not only brings deliverance from the things that are trying to have their claws dug into us as a different, alternate identity, it also brings healing as it goes. Because if the Spirit of the Lord is in us and given full reign over who we are, healing and deliverance just seem to happen. And the anointing and the calling of Jesus Christ through the presence of His Holy Spirit in our lives transforms who we are to the world. So much so that some random dude gets his body tossed down the steps. It happens to land on the bones of Elisha. It's no longer his ministry, but the promise of the anointing that still remains. And he comes alive. It just so happens that the clothes of the disciples were so anointed by the presence of God that they handed them out to the sick because they didn't have enough hours in the day, and the sick touched the clothes of those who hold the anointing, and they were healed. God works in impossible ways through impossible means at the right time. The salvation, the pure salvation, the things we say are so important. And listen how it says in verse 36, but I tell you, and when Jesus says something like that, he's asking us to open both ears and shut our one mouth in this moment. On the day of judgment, people will have to give an account for every careless or useless word they speak. For by your words, reflecting your spiritual condition, you will be justified and acquitted of the guilt of sin. And by your words, rejecting of me, you will be condemned and sentenced. These are serious warnings. And a lot of times we're like, oh, but God, I don't want to think about that. He's not saying this to bring you down. He's saying this to say, let your words be few, but let them be mine. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that your character can follow suit and it will be proved right in what you say as identity markers over yourself and over other people. And the greatest example, and the reason I wanted that song, is what happens when God gives us words to speak. We're going to get to a part of Ezekiel 37 in a second, but it was amazing to me this week, hearing words spoken over people and being a part of prayer that was spoken over people. These were declarations of not just niceties. These were words that were spoken that came only from one source, from somebody who didn't know anybody or their circumstance, and they spoke right to an area of need and addressed it directly. That's God saying, I love you here. The greatest burden you have in your life, I'm speaking life into that here. Well, what does that look like? What does that look like? Because the words are important, but what if God gives you words? It goes something like this. So I prophesied as I was commanded. That means God spoke to Ezekiel to give him a task to speak on God's behalf. That's how good God is. We have gifts and talents that are needed in this world because God uses us to be his vessel of hope and life and love because we first experienced it and shaped, molded, changed by it for people around us. You can't speak life to someone if he hasn't made you fully alive and spoken it into you. The word of the Lord is live. We're getting to that. And as I prophesied, there was a thundering noise. Behold, a rattling sound. And the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and behold, and there were sinews on the bone, and flesh grew, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, son of man. Say to the breath, thus says the Lord, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, so they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they came to life, and they stood up on their feet, an exceedingly great army. When you do the will of the Lord, see, we hear about this story, we think, oh, that's a nice story, but what if God is calling you to be a life giver right now? What if he's calling you to receive fully, be transformed by the renewing of your mind, to open yourself up for maybe the first time in your life to fully receive him, to lay down any guilt, shame, doubt, or anything you've been carrying along with you because you found the limit of the experience of your faith. You think, this is it? Oh, I wish that my life was like the scriptures. And Jesus is saying, is this as far as you're going to let me go? Because now is the time, we are in a stage of life right now where people need to experience substance like they have never felt before in their faith. And God is doing something right now that says, yes, live. I am not the same person I was, not because I'm so good, because he is so good. He took away everything that was literally killing me in my body, in my mind, in my soul. Someone came up to our house this week, someone that I had never met. Only one person had contact with them, and they hadn't seen them in 2 years. But their name came to mind. They said, can we add this person to this list of people who need prayer and healing? I said, yeah. And we passed it along, and I saw this person who I'd never met before in my life, and they were walking up our driveway. They have been sick since 2020. They have been bedridden with sickness since 2020. And they came up 45 years old, looking like they were 92 years old, and they had a walker, and they had to stop halfway up my driveway because they couldn't make it to the door. And I saw this person gasping for air, a breath that they could never catch again. It was impossible in that state, and my mouth fell open as I'm staring through this window at this person I'd never seen, and I felt such pain and sadness and hopelessness because that's what they were feeling, but I also felt the love of Christ for that person. And they eventually fought their way up, and Melody ran out and greeted them and took them by the arm and helped bring in their walker and put that in the kitchen and walked them in. They got their shoes off, and they shuffled over to the chair, which was called the hot seat because it sat in the middle of the room where we could all lay hands. And we started praying, and we started praying and declaring and speaking life and healing as God prompted and led. And this person, as there was a prayer at the end, was a repeat after me. They started off so quiet and so raspy because that's all they had. And by the end of it, they had authority and they had volume in their breath. And this person, as soon as we said amen, started singing and leading us in the doxology. And she hadn't sung in 3 years because that was the first thing the enemy took from her. And she worshiped the Lord with us. And then you could see her braced to get out of the chair. And she put herself up and said, "Oh." She stood upright and she took proper steps. She went to the door and she got her shoes. And as she was walking, Melody put her walker on the outside. And we watched her all together, huddled like a bunch of creeps through the window. And we drew the blinds and we stared at her back. And as she unfolded the chair and she took the posture of the hunched over look, and she grabbed hold and she positioned her feet to what she was used to. And she went to move and she just said, "No." And she stood up and folded it, and she dragged it behind her. She walked to her car with authority and power. And we checked in with her several days later. "How are you doing?" "I am doing well because I am healed. I was upright." She said, "I was upright for 12 hours. I was able to take my daughter to a dentist appointment that I haven't been able to do in 3 years. And I am good." You better start. I'm not going to stop.
I know. Okay, yep. Just to give some context as well for this person, I just went back and found a Facebook post from February 8th that she had posted. She said, "Helped give the dog a bath yesterday. That used up all the energy I had stored from the previous week, and then I slept 16 hours straight." And so... when I got the message that Aaron was referring to, I was like, oh my gosh, you know, nervous to text her, but excited. And I said, "How are you doing?" And she said, "So much better. My daughter got her wisdom teeth removed today, and I took her to that. And I've been upright from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. with no post-exertional malaise, no aches and chills and sweating." And she said, "I'm excited to start a rehab program." Thank you, Jesus.
Then God said to me, "Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are completely cut off. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, this is what the Lord God says. Behold, I will open up your graves and make you come up out of your graves, my people. Then you will know with confidence that I am the Lord. And when I have opened your graves, I made you come up out of your graves, my people. I will put my spirit in you and you will come to life." The breath and the wind of the Lord is the exact same phrasing that was used in Genesis when he spoke into existence all things and all life, and the intimacy of life comes through the animation, through the Holy Spirit. I saw someone this week that when we laid hands and prayed on them near the end, the Lord said, "I want you to say, be filled with the Holy Spirit." And I whispered it because it didn't feel like it needed to be loud shouting. And this person went into a trance-like state for about 40 minutes, which was amazing. I saw somebody else who I've known for a few years, and our paths have been brought together. This person came And they were very, very combative throughout this whole prayer. They were there. There was a part of them that was glad to be there, but it was something else was fighting and very argumentative. And this person sat there with a posture like this. And they said, I got to tell you, I don't feel any different. I don't feel anything. And then as soon as they left, 20 minutes later, they text me this amazing thing saying, God has done some amazing, impossible things. What you didn't know is this was the worst day of my life leading up to this prayer, and I was going to kill myself if it didn't go well. Thankfully, I didn't know that. And then the moment I got there, I thought, well, even if I don't kill myself, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to completely give up on this Jesus thing. I'm going to live my life to make as much money as possible because that's all I'm good for. That's all I'm good for. I have no value besides what I can make. He says, this week. And this person then said, those thoughts were held off at the front door. As soon as I stepped in, it was removed. And they couldn't follow me back when I left. And God is doing amazing things. And he had a word spoken over him, and he had all these things, and he was coming back asking questions, and I was able to speak life, and the Lord was giving me words that I didn't know, but I was speaking them into him, and then just like, hey, this is it. He's like, that makes sense. That's it. That's it. And it registered because something in him said, yes. Live. Live. And it wasn't just the animation of the Spirit of God brought them to a place where they can even acknowledge that they were hopeless. And then he said, Son of Man, breathe my Spirit into them. Prophesy that the Spirit is coming so they may live. That is the whole purpose. That is the sole purpose of Jesus Christ in his ministry in our lives. It's just like when Martha was talking with Jesus. And she was arguing with him and being very honest in her compromised emotional grieving state because her brother is dead. If only you were here when I asked you to be here. If only you answered my prayer as I sent them out. If only you came through. But I still believe. See, at this point, Martha's being honest about where she's at in her walk, in her life. And she's also, unbeknownst to her, exposing the limits of her faith. God says, don't round that corner. Let's straighten that line out because you're missing the point. He says, do you not know that I am the resurrection and the life? And she responds with, yes. And do you not know that your brother can be brought back and resurrected? She says, yes, I know in the last days that you will raise all people. He's like, I'm not talking about that. I said, I am now. I am able and willing now, not just then. But see, here's one thing, is since we've grown up in Western culture and since the Western church really has been so complacent and comfortable and spiritually complacent, I'll say, speaking for myself and a lot of experiences for a long time, because we've been blessed so abundantly with so much, we think, well, God hasn't, so God won't. That is a subconscious fear and thought that we've all had ingrained into us at one point or another. And Jesus says, but I am, not I will be, the resurrection and the life. And I know there's fear. And I know there's doubt. I get that. We're people. But God is doing amazing things now. And what's interesting is eventually when he convinces Martha, and he's eventually able to go with them and journey with them on this destination to the place with the problem that he's there to fix, he takes time to journey it with them, even though they don't understand the purpose of the journey is to show them that he loves them. The shortest verse in the scriptures is recorded in the story when it says that Jesus wept. And I always thought, why are you spending time grieving and weeping with the people that are hurt? He says, because I love them. If I was just to fix all the issues, they wouldn't maybe know that I love them. I need to spend time in the gutters. I need to spend time with them on their knees and their broken, compromised states before I raise them up to the mountaintops. I need you to know that I'm in it with you. Tell my people, I weep and grieve with them. I am not hard-hearted towards them. I embrace them. I love them. I hurt with them. I cry and I mourn. But I am here to give life and life abundantly. Can you let me change the way you see yourself and the limits of your circumstances? Can you let me change the way you see yourself and the way you see others around you and the limits of their circumstances? Because I am the resurrection and the life now. And he finally got to the place where he said, okay, let's do this. And that's a scary place. Even if you've journeyed with God all the way up until you know that he's either going to or he isn't going to, that fear comes in. And this is what the scripture says about it, because I think it's very interesting. Jesus said, take away the stone. And Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, by this time there have been an offensive odor. He has been dead 4 days and it is hopeless. And some of us are praying the same thing in our lives and our circumstances right now. It is hopeless. I know that you will. I know that on the last days. I know that when my resurrection body comes, I know that in heaven everything's now. What about now? How come we're able to justify shutting down the power of God now? Because of our fear and our doubt and because of what was is going to continue to be. What if he says, behold, I'm doing a new thing. Can you not perceive it? God, give us eyes to see. God, give us ears to hear because your spirit is calling and prompting now. It is hopeless. But that's okay if we're being honest in that state. At least go to Jesus with it. Go to Jesus with it because this is what he says. Did I not say to you that if you believe in me, you will see the glory of God, the expression of his excellence? Did I not promise you this? Are God's promises yes and amen? We need to make our minds up about that. And is he going to be true to his word about his promises? We got to make our minds up about it if he has to. And then it's interesting that Jesus speaks. The power of words, right? Because I love it. He prays. We often skip over that part. We just go to Lazarus, come forth. We're getting there. But he prays first. And listen as he states his intention. Father, I thank you that you have heard me. And I know that you always hear me. Because of the people standing around, I say this so that they may believe you have sent me. It's not for my benefit that I'm praying. It's for everyone around. Because I know that you hear me. I know that they hear me. And I know that they are heard by you. You have sent me. You have made me your representative. And then when he said this, he shouted with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! And out came the man who had been dead. And then he said to them, unwrap him and release him. What I love about this verse is it's so honest, and it does paint this glorious picture about how good God is. He's here to bring life, and life abundantly. And I know it's so easy to get dissuaded by situations. They get overwhelmed by circumstances. And maybe even, I can see on some people's faces right now, you're not buying a single word I'm saying. That's okay. I am not God. I'm not responsible to make you believe anything. You are. And if you're not asking the right questions to the right source, which is not me, by the way, it's him. Here's the thing about it, that the church has been so good at putting the pastor or paid representatives or the administration or the pastor's wife or deacons or elders or deaconesses and everything else as the intercessors. Go to Jesus, people. If something is lacking or needing, ask him to reveal it to you and don't stop asking until he shows it. Oh, I found the end of myself, so I'm just going to sit here and wait. And I say that not belligerently, and not to condemn anyone. I was there. I didn't know where to go. And Jesus said, there's more you do not even know yet. Will you let me show you? And it took me hitting a rock bottom state in order to get there. And it was out of my control. The fear, gone. The doubt sometimes comes back, but I know exactly where to give it when it does. But when he starts speaking, and he is speaking and doing impossible things. Our friends always call it, you and Melody are on the fast track. I never thought I would have the gift of prophecy. I don't even like saying that because it's like, ugh, it has a heavy weight. But God is speaking words of life. He's saying, live. Aaron, are you my child? Yes, I've got a word for this person. I need you to share it with them. No, in Jesus' name. He says, live. I want them to live. If it's going to be on me, it's not on you. If it doesn't come to fruition the way you think, it's not a failure. I need you to be obedient. Will you be obedient? Will you learn to trust me? Because you thought you've been walking this whole time. You were crawling. I need you to run. I need my church to run with me. And in order to do that, they need to be so interwoven in who I am and what I'm doing. God says, live. It was so interesting to see this, and relationships restored. And it was so powerful, this private moment where relationships and forgiveness and love and healing need to take place. And the moment, I mean the exact moment that took place, this other person got their physical healing. In that moment, because God was trying to work on them in this way. You were seeking this. That's going to come when this takes place. And they're like, well, when's that going to happen? God's like... And then we're like, what? Now you go quiet? Is this thing on? Because it's not for us to know, but I'm telling you right now, the healing is not isolated to one area. It is a total healing. Salvation work to take root is going to be everything. It's all or it's nothing. And some people got a word of just sit and learn and be taught. And that's just, what does that look like? And God's like, all that it's this. It's like I told you, when Mel and I had to fast and pray a couple weeks ago, I guess. Three? Was it that long? All the weeks, I mean, it's been a lot of prayer, so it's blending together. But as we were stepping in, I was like, God, what do we do? What does this look like? How do I fast right, was the question going through my mind. Now, my motive was, I want to do it right for God. But I was anguishing over, what do I need to do for him? And he stopped me dead in my tracks, and I finally gave him the time of day. The Spirit's like, it's not about you in that way. Stop trying to do for me when what you need is to receive from me. You're only giving up something as a means of symbolizing this in the Spirit. So I can do this to you, because that's what you need. You don't need to do more. You need to make yourself able to receive all. A full measure. For my calling, my grace, how I view you is irrevocable. The only thing that can change is your decision about how much you let me in. The Bible actually calls that a fall from grace. Wow. But the following scripture after that, this descriptor of a fall from grace says, but it's so easy to choose Christ. He says, live. As the worship team is going to come up here, I'm going to unstick the pages of my Bible. Spilled coffee on it this morning as I was reading. This is a portion of Psalm 80. And I want you to hear this. It says, hear us, O Shepherd of Israel. Hear us, O God. Stir up your power and come and save us. Restore us, O God. Cause your face to shine on us with favor and approval that we may be saved, healed, delivered. It's so interesting when Scripture talks about the face of God. Those who are called by my name, turn from their wicked evil ways and seek my face. Confess their sins, I'm just to forgive them, and I will heal their land. That means everything that they've been a part of, everything that has been contaminated, everything will be restored and made new. It's interesting, he says, seek my face, because here's something else I learned this week. When we say the word presence, God, I want to be in your presence, scripturally it means the face of God. Every time you use that word, biblically, definition is the face of God. Lord, I want to live in your presence. I mean, he's right there staring you in the face with his face. It's intimate. It's powerful. It is life-changing. He says, is that what you really want? Because if you do and you stand in my glory, everything's going to fade away and everything's going to change. I'm not here for a part of you that you think you want to give me. I'm here for the whole thing because I love you, all of you. I want all of you. I need all of you if you're going to give all of me to the world. How are we going to breathe life if we haven't fully received it? If we are living our spiritual lives on a ventilator, just staying alive, Jesus says, I want you to live. I need you to breathe before you can breathe into others. You know what the biblical definition of inspiration is? And be careful when you use that word. Oh, I felt inspired today, did you? It means that you have been God-breathed, full life moment in Jesus Christ. So be very careful if you use that word inappropriately. That means you've been made alive. That is a declaration and a yes and an amen statement, and you are in agreement with that statement before God. You say that and you're not ready, ho ho, you might just come alive. The rest of that, sorry, I'm going all over here. Restore us, O God. Cause your face to shine on us with favor and approval that we may be saved. Then we shall not turn back from you. Revive us, and we will call on the name of Jesus Christ. Restore us, O Lord, God of hosts. Cause your face to shine on us in favor and approval, and we shall be saved, healed, and delivered. This last song is called The Blessing. I want you to receive it, and I want you to speak it as a prayer and a declaration of everyone around you. And just really focus. So the words are quite simple. I grew up Anglican, so this really speaks to me. But just think of the words, and I want you to say, God, help me to fully receive. Is there anything lacking? Holy Spirit, let me know. I want to live and live abundantly. I don't want to be held back in any way, shape, or form. If there's anything I need to confess and turn away from, make it known and give me the strength to do so. And set me anew. Make me whole in Jesus' name.
Coming and you're going and you're weeping.
for you. It's 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 for you.
For every sin known and unknown. Lord God, we confess right now. Jesus, for everything we need to let go, we choose right now to let it go. And we repent, and we ask that you supernaturally keep us in that repentance. headed your way, not the wrong way. Headed your way, not our way. God, if you are for us, then who can be against us? And you say time and time again that you are for us, and everything you do and everything Jesus did was for me. 2,000 years later, in my circumstances, God, you died, you took it. You rose, you gave it. And everything in between, Lord God, everything between now and our last breath, everything between now and your kingdom come forever, God, let your will be done. And it starts with the church, Lord God. I humble myself before you. I say, Jesus, come. Take me as I am. Use me as you see fit. God, pour out your spirit upon this whole place and everybody in here that we are standing on holy ground because you have made us holy. We are the holy of holies, Lord God. We are yours. Amen. He is for us. God, let us hear the stories and the testimonies and the journeys of the transforming of who we are by the renewing of our mind in you. Not under our own strength or our own efforts, God, but your Spirit speaking, leading, guiding, anointing, inspiring, breathing, 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 new life, new life, new life, praying against the hopelessness, the grief, the worry, the doubt, the baggage, the fear, the pain, and everything has come before, Lord God. It will melt away in your presence. Every physical ailment gone and done in Jesus' name. Every lame person will walk. Every demon-possessed person will be free and liberated and filled with the Holy Spirit. Every sickness cured, Lord God, as you see fit in Jesus' name. I didn't want to speak this. Full transparency. Fear. That's one thing God's been working on me on is fear of man. The people appeasement, God says, no more. And I say, sometimes. He's working and he is a gracious God. But in Mark 16, later Jesus appeared to the disciples and he called them to account for their unbelief and their hardness of heart. Because they had not believed those who had seen him after he had risen from death. And quite honestly, some of us need God to work with our unbelief and our hardness of heart right now. But that's not where the story ends. It says, then he said to them, and he spoke, and words have power. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. He was believed will be saved. But he who is not believed will be condemned. These signs will accompany those who have believed in my name. They will cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up serpents and they will drink deadly poison and they will not be hurt. They will lay hands on the sick and they will get well. Because I am the resurrection and life. You know what's neat about God? He's got a really good sense of humor. This week, too, we had somebody come through our house, and they were so desperate. They love the Lord so much, and they've been walking with the Lord so much, but they've been limited in their spirit. And they've been praying for years that they would have the gift of tongues, and they come to a place they would never get it. They believe that. And they believed it so strongly that even when it was prayed right then and there, it didn't come. And the person saying it says, this is for today. This is for today. Not in the next life, not next week. This is for today. And that person couldn't get past that disbelief. But as soon as they left, they went home by themselves. And they're messaging me because what I didn't, well, actually, I did tell them this and I felt kind of bad. I have been faking the praying of tongues for years because I thought, I'll fake it until I make it. God will give it in his times. I'll pray what I've heard. My heart's in the right place. I thought, eh. And as someone else is getting prayed for the gifting of tongues, my mouth opens up and I start speaking. I'm like, what is that? That's not what I had in my mind. And God says, ta-da! You might be in the presence of somebody else receiving, and just because you put yourself in the posture of reception, you might get some of the overflow. It's so good. Amen. Because he is so good. But the thing that limits is this. God isn't done and he's not unable because he's just not able anymore. He's not tired. The youth will grow tired and weary, but not him. He hasn't stopped doing miracles because we haven't seen it. He is waiting for a people who will humble themselves and seek his face to be saved, healed, delivered, and set apart. The choice is ours. He loves us that much. We will limit or we will flow. Live. In Jesus' name. Amen. You keep doing that, the Spirit's going to knock me on my keister. You think I'm kidding? We have a very special anniversary coming up. Sharon and Angelo, so happy early anniversary in a couple days this week. And two birthdays. Oh, Luini walked away. I was going to say happy. She knew. She knew I was going to say happy birthday. Happy birthday anyway, Luini. We're going to sing to her, and we're going to sing to Bex, who's around somewhere. Okay. She's going to hate that, but that's awesome. Works for me. Yes, thank you. Jesus Revolution here. Yes, bring your own supper. Okay, it's not potluck in the sense of sharing with everyone. We wanted to make it bring what you're going to eat. That way everything gets eaten. And that way you're responsible for your own cleanup. Because what happens with potluck, and I love you guys, you tend to come and expect others to clean up. So this is a be responsible for yourself type situation. Bring your own food, dinner, and a movie. It's going to start at 5:30. I'm going to be here at 5 to help set up for it. And whoever wants to come and help set up can come and help set. I looked at two people, but I got y'all. 5 for setup, 5:30 start time. It's going to be great. Happy birthday to Bex and Luini. I had to spell it out how it sounds because I don't know how to spell that. But follow me. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Bex and Luini. Happy birthday to you. Wow. Well, I hope you're going in joy and peace and that you are being hit with the Holy Spirit stick, as Melody says. Have a great week. We love you guys. Oh. Yeah, so one of the things, thank you. On Mother's Day, what we do, this church has been historically good for this, and this happened, Derwin did this long before I got here, and it's going to carry on. So the roses are not just for the mothers, but those who don't have children. Those who can't have children, every female in here is going to get a rose, and every child is going to get that. Huh? I can't remember. Mums? Oh, whoa. Oh, I got chills. That's good. Oh, that's good. That's like a prophecy flower. I'm digging that. Okay. So, you're going to have to bear with us. We have to wrap it because these are thorny. Happy Mother's Day. You're very welcome. I guess I can shut this off.